Get ready. 10 seconds. 5 seconds. Start. Mr. Chairman, sir, I would like to say a few words about the motion of thanks on President's address. We are lucky that the reins of our country are in the hands of a young leader. Sir, you may be aware that youth always aspires to attain great heights, and this is possible because they are fearless, courageous, and have a will to work. They carry the people along with them. History bears testimony to this. A youthful person is always dauntless, courageous, and has a goal to achieve. Hence, our Honorable Prime Minister not merely aspires to take the country, rather he has resolved to accomplish the whole task on a war footing. Here, I would like to say that India stands for firm determination. Those who are incapable to fulfill the resolution can never be considered Indian. The Honorable Prime Minister has initiated social revolution with full enthusiasm. He has launched a number of schemes for the upliftment of society and advancement of all the sections, particularly the youth. Consequently, social changes are taking place and various programs have been launched for improving the standard of living of the villagers. New shape is being given to the rural areas. The Honorable Prime Minister is not only concerned but also perturbed and anxious at the prevailing poverty and unemployment in rural areas and is determined to eradicate them. That is why the Honorable President mentioned the possibility of social and economic changes in the country. Employment has been guaranteed. The central government has made a provision to provide employment at least to one member in each family living below the poverty line. The farmers, workers, and youth have acquired adequate resources. They are now capable to fulfill their aspirations which they had dreamt of. They are fully satisfied with their means of livelihood. They are developing interest, faith, and dedication in political activities. But unfortunately, the people who consider themselves to be the successors of Mahatma Gandhi, the man who was totally against speaking, hearing, and seeing evils, have been indulging in all these evil actions. We would like to urge upon them that India has its own traditions, culture, and historical background. Indian culture is a guidance principle for the entire world. But we ourselves have lost our way and nothing can be expected from such people. We will have to revive our identity which we have lost at present. Today, democracy and socialism are flourishing and the feelings of brotherhood and unity are getting strong. We are celebrating Nehru centenary this year. We should try to evaluate the programs launched by Pandit Nehru. The government will have to propagate his principles. Our words and deeds vary. So, we will have to give a practical shape to the programs of Pandit Nehru. Otherwise, we would not be worthy of calling ourselves to be the successors of Mahatma Gandhi. So, I would urge upon the members of opposition to continue our struggle for the protection of the weak from the mighty. We believe in remaining hungry and providing food to others. We want to remove the problems of others while remaining ourselves amidst them. We are ready to face inconvenience in order to help others. We can remain without clothes if need be. But people are not aware as to how far the country has progressed, how far it has enriched its resources, and the place it occupies in the world today. The India's tricolor is flying high. The credit goes to Pandit Nehru and Srimati Indira Gandhi. We are moving ahead perpetually with the flag in our hands. Sri Rajiv Gandhi has been following the same principles in the national and international affairs. It is our duty to keep our flag flying high in the world. The government is resolved to check the tendencies of terrorism, separatism, or bloodshed. It is our foremost duty, otherwise we wouldn't be performing our duty earnestly. In view of this, it becomes essential for every citizen of India, particularly we MPs, to do our duty in the earnest manner. We would be worthy to enjoy our rights if we perform our duty well. Only when we would be able to solve the problems. So, I would like to urge upon you that being the members of Parliament, we too have a right, the right to speak truth and nothing but truth only. We would discharge our duty very earnestly and would be honest to our responsibilities, otherwise we would not be able to call ourselves the successors or the followers of Mahatma Gandhi. I extend my thanks to the Honorable Prime Minister for executing the principles of Mahatma Gandhi and policies of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and Srimati Indira Gandhi. Rural upliftment, particularly for those youth who are living below the poverty line, is being undertaken. Efforts are being made to bring the illiterate children to the national mainstream by providing educational facilities through Navodaya Vidyalayas, which have been opened under the new education policy of Sri Rajiv Gandhi. But these Navodaya Vidyalayas should be opened in rural areas because 40% of theoretical students in these are from rural areas. Mr. Vice Chairman, Sir, at a time when the world is moving steadily towards a detent, notwithstanding a few setbacks, in the pursuit of general international peace, it is particularly disquieting to us in the Indian Ocean area to learn of the measures taken by the US authorities in going ahead with the building of the military base. Now, we can legitimately claim some credit for having done this, having been important partners in this movement towards non-alignment, towards disarmament, and towards detent. The House will recall that under Panditji, under Indiraji, under Rajivji, and under Lal Bahadur Shastri, we have continued the relentless quest for detent. We have always spoken up for disarmament, and in fact, we have given our own interpretation of disarmament, our own picture of disarmament.